Thanks for coming to my talk today. I'm Li Yangping and I'm from Dunman High School along with some of my volunteer friends. Okay, so today I'd like to present my project on network security and analysis with Python. Okay, so first things first, everyone here has internet connection, right? So the thing is that everyone here is connected by that today, at work, at home, or even on mobile phones. So all these internet connections are some form of network. A network is a connection made by two points in order to transfer information from one place to another. So since all of us are connected by some form of network today, there are high priority targets for cyber attack by malicious users. So it's important for us to improve network security and to reduce vulnerabilities. For example, companies in particular will have more incentive to improve network security because they are at more risk. For example, they are prone to commercial espionage or leaking of important company secrets or suffer major financial losses if they are hacked because their servers are vulnerable. So if you remember the Sony hacking that happened last year, 2014, they were hacked allegedly by North Koreans, and they set aside $50 million in their financial report in 2015 in order to handle this problem, and this became global news. So let me talk to you about how network works. So in a network connection, all information is sent through discrete chunks of data called packets. So these packets occur in all connections. For example, the Wi-Fi we are using now, or Ethernet cable, all of them transmit data through packets. And these packets contain raw byte data. Now, raw byte data might seem messy because they're just ones and zeros and stuff like that. But since all of them in these packets, all of them follow a fixed format called a protocol format. And with these fixed formats, we are able to make sense of these data, ones and zeros, and able to learn information about these packets. So the next point I want to let all of you know is that all packets contain a layer structure. So a layer structure conveys information step by step in every layer. So these are some examples of real-life objects with a layered structure. This 九层蛋糕 or 9-layer cake will contain multiple layers, but all eventually part of the same object. And same goes for this Russian doll, which you have to, in order to unpack it and get to the root, the smallest one, you have to unpack each and every layer one by one in order to get to the end. So like these objects, a real packet structure contains multiple layers. So let me go through this with you, because this might be a bit abstract. Okay. So the first layer in a generic packet is the frame header layer. And this frame header layer tells you the medium of which the packet is transmitted to, for example, Ethernet. So if the frame header layer has an Ethernet, it says Ethernet, then you'll know that it comes through an Ethernet cable or something. And the next layer is the IP header layer, which stands for the Internet Protocol layer. And the next layer, and the third layer, is the TCP or UDP header, which is a transport layer protocol. And it provides an interface between the Internet Protocol layer and the application data. And finally, the application data, which is the main root of any packet, contains unique information. So every packet will have unique data in the application portion. So let me zoom in into what a protocol header is, specifically the TCP protocol header, right? So in this TCP protocol header, it is what defines a TCP packet. In all TCP packets, they will contain a TCP protocol header. Okay, so the first two fields, the source port and the destination port, tells us important information about the packet. While the next two fields, the sequence number and acknowledgement number, shows us what is the most tells us important information that is only native to the TCP protocol itself. So every layer will tell us important information of the packet itself, which is why a layered structure is useful for all packets. And all protocol formats on the internet are standardized, which means that every open protocol will have this documentation uploaded online, which can search Google with. For example, the ARP, UDP, all of these are known open protocols, which facilitate information communication on the internet. So I would like to talk about the next category of protocols, which are proprietary protocols. These proprietary protocols do not have their protocol format information uploaded freely on the internet, which means that these protocol information are not public. Since they are private, network security software is unable to understand the byte data inside because it's in some form of different language. For example, if I tell you now in English, how are you? It makes sense because all of you here understand English. But if I speak to you in Cantonese, for example, then most of you who don't understand Cantonese will not be able to understand what I just said. This is an example. So one more thing is that there's a difference between proprietary and encrypted protocols. Because some of you may have heard of encrypted protocols, which actually are information that need to be decrypted before they can be understood. As for proprietary protocols, they are protocols which contain information that we do not understand, where the protocol format information is not public. So there are two different things. For the purpose of my project, which I'll explain to you later, we do not use any encrypted protocols for the use of my project. So all protocols used in my project are in the clear. So here comes the fun part. I'll be explaining to you one of the main industrial methods for network security in the industry, which is deep packet inspection. Deep packet inspection is a process where network security software reads deeply into a packet, which reads the application data layer and searches for malicious information or bad keywords, and it will flag it out and send this packet to the block the packet in the network and send this information to the administrator if any malicious information is detected. So when this deep packet inspection software encounters proprietary protocols, it gets confused because it's unable to understand the information inside them. So not only that, there's also a problem of scale, because I'll let you know that all information that that's transmitted to a network, for example this wire here, will all contain thousands of packets flowing through in a minute. So deep packet inspection software must not only work accurately, but they also must work on a large scale where thousands of packets flow through a minute. So if there are proprietary protocols in a network, they'll be disruptive to the deep packet inspection process. And so deep packet inspection is hindered by proprietary protocols, and they are an obstacle. So how does the industry deal with this problem? One of the main methods that they use is called an anomaly-based intrusion detection system, where it understands the baseline of a network and then understand the baseline of the network and then check it constantly, and if any anomalous behavior is detected in the network, it flags it out and returns and logs it, informs the administrator. So now I'd like to talk about my project finally. Okay, so my project is named Analytics, and its motivation is to help out in deep packet inspection. It's an initial experimental study where I use Python to learn more about protocol information and protocol formats. I think of idea heuristics to learn about unknown protocol formats and to attempt to decode proprietary protocols and think of heuristics to accomplish these goals. Afterwards, I conduct experiments on this information and to determine if my heuristics in analytics are effective or not. So, the reason why I use Python is because it is easy to implement my heuristics and it is fast to test with. It's not like other languages where you have to like, it's much more difficult to do so in other languages. So Python is very easy to implement my heuristics in. So I'd like to talk about the two main heuristics that I have used to detect for certain fields in unknown protocols. There are many fields that are common in all protocols, but two of which I've chosen are constant fields and enumerator fields. I'd like to explain what they are. A constant field is a field where every byte in this packet of the same protocol will stay the same. So if this specific byte or this chunk of bytes are the same for all packets of the same protocol, then we know that it is a constant field. So analytics checks for that. For enumeration fields, currently analytics is only able to check for fields, for these fields in the same position. If they are in variable positions, it will be more difficult to check for these fields, so it can't do it yet. Enumeration fields are fields, they remain in the same position in the same protocol, but at this same position, there are only a limited number of values, which is quite significant to say when there are thousands of packets in the same protocol and they only have a limited number of values in this same position, then we know that the information there is significant. So with these two heuristics, analytics attempts to understand and learn more about protocol information and protocol formats in order to learn more about how we can decode them. Constant fields in protocol headers are significant because they may represent paddings, protocol version, or reserve fields. And enumeration fields may represent switches or the next protocol, for example. With these two information, we're able to learn a little bit more, not everything, but a little bit more about unknown protocol headers, which is useful in security applications. Let me show you examples of constant fields and enumeration fields in a very well-known packet, a protocol header, which is the Internet Protocol. So as you can see, the constant fields and enumeration fields are marked out in this Internet Protocol. A constant field is the version, because the version currently mostly use IPv4. IPv4 stands for Internet Protocol version 4, so the version there will be constant. And for enumeration fields, there are flags and protocol, which only have a limited number of values regardless of how many packets there are in the protocol. And another example is the ICMP datagram, where the type and the code field are actually enumeration fields. But for this specific instance, the type and code are constant in the same situation. So these tell us significant information about them as well. Okay, with analytics, right, I've also coded another function in it to check for the entropy level of all positions in a packet. So analytics, through its enumeration function, is able to check for the entropy level of the packet, and therefore a given set of packets in a file. In order to learn the entropy level, we use the formula to calculate the probability of every value occurring in a single position. Then afterwards, we are able to calculate entropy, which tells us the amount of information that can be gained from a packet. And analytics is also I've also included some useful graphing features in analytics. These graphing features are very useful for manual analysis, because currently my program is only useful for manual analysis. So graphing features are very helpful. And later I'll go into in depth into one of them. I use Plotly for one for my graphing features in analytics. So it's like there's an API used. Right. Okay, so you guys can log on to plotly/curlyting lee.yangping in order to see the dump of my graph that I've done for my project. So here comes the stage of my experiments. After I've implemented all the heuristics, I've tested my heuristics on 14 protocol headers, which are stated there. And then afterwards, I tested to see if they are useful, if my heuristics are effective or not. For every experiment, I have to collect the data in a systematic way and then test on it. So I gather many assorted packets from either my usual browsing network or a malware dump site online called Contagio Dump. I collect assorted packet capture files and then filter the protocol that I want from Wireshark. After that, I merge them in one large packet capture file which contains only one single protocol that I'm looking to experiment with. So many packet capture files which are filtered, they are merged into one single packet capture file before being tested into analytics for use in my conclusions. So why do I do this? Because there's an experimental error in my setup where the data that are used for my browsing network or Contagio is not able to simulate the true randomness of a real network. So false positives will be observed with the data that I collect, and therefore they'll affect my experiment. And so for consistency, I will mark these false positives as incorrect during my evaluation. So the reason why I use the merge files is in order to attempt to reduce this experimental error to make the packet capture files that are used on analytics more random, but there's still the inherent experimental error present. So I'll now demonstrate how to use analytics with one of the graphs that I've obtained on a very common protocol called the transmission control protocol. For this experiment, I used a single packet capture of 200 packets, all of them using the TCP protocol inside. The definition of a TCP protocol is one that contains a TCP header. Okay. So this is the information that I receive when I use the constant analysis with my analytics. From here, see that there are six different distinct constants that I found. There's a six byte one, 2 4 byte ones, and a few three other ones. And all of them are significant because they repeat in all 200 packets in the same protocol. So the next graph I've created is the constants graph, which is a graph of where a single constant is found in the file. So by analyzing this OA00EOO constant, I noticed that all of them occur at the same position in all TCP packets. This is very significant because what are the odds of a single chunk appearing at the same position for 200 same packets? It can't be a coincidence. So it's something significant, and we'll look more into that later. This is the enumeration graph that I have created to analytics visualization function. As we can see, right, there are a few fields that are noticeable. For example, the plateau at bytes 1 to 12, there are two peaks up there and three peaks up there. and constants found at the various fields there. Sorry, I don't have a laser pointer. Right. So after we cross check the previous results with this result, right? For example, this 08, this 4-byte chunk of constants. Actually, if I notice the constants all appearing at position 12, then we are able to. Is my armor there? No, it's not. We are able to see that this constant actually appears in the 4-byte chunk over there. So through cross-checking the results with analytics, I'm able to form conclusion about it and learn more about the protocol format. And this also works for unknown protocol formats as well. So not only the TCP protocol, which is only for demonstration, but most unknown protocols and proprietary protocols. So after all of the evaluation and all the experiments I've conducted, I finally get to evaluate my results. Manual analysis of the protocol header was compared against ground truth from the protocol documentation. So what this means is that I Google the official protocol format and analyze them byte-wise. I mark each and every byte as constant and not constant, enum and not enum. And the accuracy of my program is detected by the true positives plus true negatives and divided by the total header length. After that, I enter all the accuracies into a final table here, where you can see that the average accuracy of detecting constant fields in the 14 protocols are 76%, 76.8%. And the average accuracy of detecting enums in all my protocols are 88.6%. So you'll notice that the accuracy for detecting constant fields is lower than accuracy of detecting enumeration fields. This is because of the experiment error I mentioned earlier, where more false positives will be found for constant fields than enumeration fields. So for example, in the SMB protocol, which is a server message block protocol, which Microsoft attempted to decode, there is a 8-byte reserve field in the protocol header, which is normally set to 0, unless there is a security features in there. So because I was only able to collect protocol headers which have everything security field 0, so analytics registered it as a constant, but in actual fact it is actually not a constant. So I had to mark my accuracy down. So this phenomenon also happens for DNS and ARP protocols. So with this, my accuracy for constants is lower than the accuracy for enumeration fields. And the limitations of, so I like to talk about the limitation of analytics, where it's only able to analyze a single protocol, and the heuristic to detect for higher level fields such as sequence numbers and dependencies are not yet implemented. So finally, I would like to conclude, analytics is just an initial experimental study to learn more about protocol information and packet data. Yeah, because of this, it has several security applications, such as to analyze the malware communications, where a malware communicates with its command server, then we can analyze the protocol of that. Or perhaps for use in deep packaging to learn more about the proprietary protocols that hinder it, or maybe it be used in software testing to test for compliance to a certain protocol between two application softwares. And that is all for my project. Thank you. Are there any questions?
How thing is applied to a real world scenario?
Okay, at the moment, right, my project is actually is an initial study. It's just having fun with Python to use Python to analyze network analyze network information. So the final aims of this project is to about protocol information to help out in deep packet inspection. But currently at this stage it's just experiments. So it's not ready to be used in the real world yet.
Have you tried focus on just one protocol and focus on just one aspect of the packet and manipulate the packet in many variations and see whether you can still find patterns within that this packet is doing that in the protocol that you think is I think that will be something interesting.
Oh yeah. Okay, thank you. Okay, so I actually forgot to mention that my project, right, is different from others because it's able to be used on network traces, and it's able to be used on proprietary protocols where the protocol format is unknown. But it doesn't actually do things like manipulate a packet or having in a sandbox and to see what happens in it after you manipulate the bytes inside. It doesn't do that. For my project is to highlight the significant bits. Then as for manipulation of the packet itself, right, I will have to leave it to other programs itself. I mean other programs, because my project doesn't do that, and it is actually, to be honest, right, to manipulate the packets automatically is quite cheap also actually.
Any other questions? Otherwise, let's give a call.